Hello, I'm Ricky.
And I'm Joe, and this is Season 6, Episode 12 of the Beer and Broadband Podcast, slated to come out on September 25th, 2023. And today we're going to be doing, for our brew, an Orange Blossum Bochet that I did. I'm not going to tell Ricky how I made this yet, because I haven't actually revealed that to him. I bottled it on May 28th, 2023, and it's 15% ABV. So, what you got going on there, buddy?
Okay, you warned me I might not like this one. Yeah. You were right. That's a bit rough.
Why don't you like it?
The citrus from the orange sticks around because of the part of the honey that's not fermentable,
mm-hmm.
and that does not mesh well at all with any of the other flavors.
Is it that bitter flavor that you're getting?
It's the sour on top of the bitter.
Okay.
It makes it taste a little bit like cough medicine.
That is not the citrus from the orange.
Really?
Okay. I had a thing of like liquid oak. It's like a fake oak that you can put into something. I thought, hey, this would be cool. This tastes awesome. Let's try to oak it. I'm going to try it with this to see how it tastes.
Mm-hmm.
5 gallons ruined. Don't ever use that. I mean, I've been drinking it, and it's gotten better over time, but the first time I drank it, I was like, ooh, that was a mistake.
Okay. So, yeah, that's where that sour
That's where that sour comes from.
Yeah. Yep.
Now, if you think about this, and you sweeten it just a little bit, because this is a dry one again, you know, like I always make them dry. If you think about this and you sweeten it a little bit, it does become a little bit more palatable at that point in time.
Yeah, I could see that. If it was a little bit sweeter, it would cover some of that sourness up.
It takes some of the sourness away, but you still get all of that like pungent smoke. It makes it almost become like a scotch, like a heavily peated scotch.
Yeah, I was going to say, as much as the other flavors to that are not great, the actual oak flavor is very pleasant.
Yes, like, it is.
It did a good job of putting the oak in there. It just, the riders on top of it are not appreciated.
And I, you know, probably if I'd have put half of it in there, it would have been great. But this is like it's the same thing as that Bochet that I made with the like Etsy bought buckwheat honey that had all the sediment in it, and it just was so, it wasn't gross, it wasn't bad, it just, it had like a kind of tanginess to it that wasn't, I didn't like it as much as the other Bochets I've made. This one has gone to that point. It's still not undrinkable, but like if I had a scale of like 1 to 10, I'd say this is a solid 4 or 5.
I can see that.
Yeah,
it's hit that point. I would not drink it straight. But I could still see applications for it in something like a cocktail or something like that.
Or like cooking stuff in it. It actually goes pretty well. Like if you like make it, like make a steak in it or something like that, or make some fish with it, it's pretty okay.
Yeah. I could definitely see the fish, especially like seafood.
Yeah.
Like some shrimp or something like that. Because they would handle that kind of, because they're also like naturally a little sweet.
Yeah.
So they'd handle that that flavor a bit better.
Yeah, so I'm not even going to like go down the road of let's talk about how this was made and everything like that. That was also the reason when I was like, well, I've got this one and I've saved it for the podcast, but I don't know that you're going to like it. Do you want to try one of these other beers?
Well, I'm glad I tried it.
Yeah.
Look, it's a very valuable experiment. We've now learned something about using the kind of liquid oak stuff. But
I feel like I pranked you.
Well, I'm a little on edge about it because, or I guess I shouldn't say I'm on edge, but I'm like on the fence about it, because on one hand those extra flavors are not very good, but it is oaked almost perfectly.
Yeah,
like the oak flavor is incredible.
Right.
Before I hit the other flavors, I was like, oh, this is a little oaky, I kind of like this. I was like, oh, I don't know about the
I'm not telling you need to take another sip. What I am saying is, if you did take another sip and you let it set on your tongue for a little bit and let those kind of like oaky flavors go away, you'll still get the sourness there, but the Bochet comes through and it actually is kind of like, it's like this is what it could have been, but it's not. You know, like it like goes up like a little mini roller coaster and then lets you back down.
Yeah, no, I can see that.
Yeah.
You know, having just done the thing you described, you know, the oakiness is still there. It coats your tongue really well. You do lose a lot of the bitterness. You just keep the sour. And the sour is just a little bit too much.
Right.
Because, like, oak can go great with so many things, but just sour is not one of them.
Nope.
It's like, Like, oaking feels like eating a piece of wood in the best way.
Mm-hmm.
So this just feels like biting into a log that's, like, going bad.
Yeah.
Like, it's, like, dissolving in your mouth. Like, no, no, that wasn't good.
Well, and see, here's the thing. I could have just dropped two or three of the spirals that I put in things normally to oak them, and it would have been just fine.
Well, I think this is a great proof of concept that oaking a Bochet is a good idea.
Yes.
Because that oak is perfect. So I definitely recommend some spirals next time.
I'm definitely going to oak a Bochet. The Orange Blossum Bochet oaked, going to happen. The Orange Blossum Bochet with liquid oak, never going to happen again.
Yeah.
Don't do that.
That might turn me off of liquid smoke for almost anything that is not like a very dark beer.
Okay, so it's not liquid smoke. This is literally
liquid oak.
Yeah, liquid oak. This was like, I don't think there's anything that I'd put this in ever. Like, I can't imagine. It would have to be, I just can't think of an application that I'd want those flavors in.
I could see it in a really dark beer that doesn't have like any, like it's not a milk stout or something, just like a standard real dark stout that had something that was complementary to the sour. Like a lot of those funky beers, you know, I can see that fitting in with.
I got you. Okay. Like a sour.
A sour stout or something?
No, there are like some. They're not stouts. They're lagers, but they are. They're like farmhouse beers, and I'm just blanking on it in the moment. But basically, they have like a little bit of a sour funkiness from Brettanomyces. And that can, you know, this might go well with something like that, like as a kind of extra flavor.
Yeah.
But that is the only way I would see it. And I'm not sure I'd like to. I don't love those types of beers anyways.
Mm.
So let's talk about upgrading the Steam Deck's SSD. Have you done any physical mods to the Steam Deck you and your wife have?
Not yet. I have the parts, but she won't let me do it. Like she's always playing on it, or she's in the middle of something. She doesn't want to take the time to transfer stuff.
Okay, so let me tell you how much time it took for me to transfer a completely full SSD and why I wouldn't spend the time doing it. Why I would spend the time doing it, but how I messed it up.
Okay.
So I've heavily software modded all the games and stuff like that on my Steam Deck. And I had like Vortex installed and had mods installed for Skyrim, which they're still there. Had all that stuff. But I had all these things, you know, set up and downloaded and done. And then I just opened up the Steam Deck. Took me about 5 minutes. Took the back off.
Mm.
It's really easy to get into. Pop the SSD out. Put it into an enclosure. Well, no. First, I got to back up a little bit. I went into desktop mode.
Yeah.
Put it on a monitor, keyboard. Plugged in the new drive that I wanted to put in. Used a DD command in the terminal, and it just
moved everything over.
Perfect one-to-one copy. I still have my old Steam Deck hard drive, SSD, so if I want to do that again, like if I wanted to like set everything back up the way I had it before, could perfectly do that, no problem. Took me about 2 hours for everything to set up, so like I started it in the morning. By the time lunch came around, opened up the Steam Deck, popped out the SSD, put in the new one, did all the stuff, and then turned it back on. And it just was like no big deal. It's like it just did the thing. 2 terabytes for, what was it, like $150, $160 at the time when I told you about the SSD. Not a problem. I now have 3 terabytes of space on my Steam Deck. On my handheld gaming device, I have 3 terabytes of space. And, I mean, what the total cost of the 512 Steam Deck plus that. So that's less than $1,000 that I spent on everything that I want to do. And the only other mod that I might do that would be a hardware mod, because I'm not going to replace the shell. I do not care anything about it. But the only other mod I might do is changing out the joysticks.
Okay.
They're really easy to do. You can get gully kit joysticks that are just drop-in replacements.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's so easy to take the back off and everything. You know, I mean, it was like 2.5 hours worth of work, and I was up and running. Now, what I did that made me reformat my Steam Deck, and what I wouldn't do again, is I accidentally hit a thing that mirrored the screen but made the screen vertical, and I could not get out of that position. I never could get it to go to the other screen that I had plugged into it again, and I never could get out of the, like, it went from being landscape to vertical, and so it was just had bars on the side and a little strip down the middle, and I couldn't navigate anything in there.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's odd.
Yeah, it was messed up.
I'm trying to think what causes that.
I hit a, it was me that caused it.
Okay. I
hit a setting. So sometimes when you've got the Steam Deck plugged into a monitor, the way it's the Linux version that it uses is set up, it will give you the options to mirror the screen and stuff like that. And it comes on these things where it's, you know, all on the screen. Right. Mm-hmm. And I accidentally clicked the wrong one, just like a misclick, and it caused it to rotate, and then everything went downhill from there.
I gotcha.
I was so sad.
Yeah, you're right. Once you've gotten that view, you can't do anything with.
Yeah.
And it's a save setting.
So I want to know, we'll probably revisit this. I mean, if you can get the Steam Deck, Alice doesn't have to even quit playing it, just as long as she plays it docked. If you can get her to let you just, you know, DD the thing, it's like a 20-minute mod.
Yeah.
To change it out. It is literally not like even a big
thing.
Yeah,
we might try that because whatever it's called, like Lies of P is coming out soon. And if you're listening to this, I think it already has come out. But she, since we have the Game Pass now, she gets that on Game Pass. So I know she'll be playing some PC games for a while, so that might be giving me a chance.
Can you install the Game Pass games on the Steam Deck? I thought that you could only do the streaming.
We've seen some instructions that you could do it like that, but more I meant like she's going to be playing it on the computer. So like her Steam Deck would be free, so I'd finally have it available to me for the time to do what I need to do.
Okay, that'd be fun. You should do it. And if you need some help, I mean, you know, like I've screwed everything up enough that I know how to do it pretty quick.
Well, there's no one better to ask how to do something than someone who's already done it and also run into issues with
it. Yes, absolutely.
Because someone who did it and like everything went perfect, if you run into problems, they're no help at all to you.
Right.
But like knowing that you ran into problems and had to reformat and set it all back up, you know what to watch out for.
Yeah, and it wasn't that bad. I just made a mistake. It wasn't even like the transfer process that caused the issue. It was me pressing a button, essentially. All right, let's talk about ChatGPT. Mm-hmm. So ChatGPT's use dropped by about 10% last month, and it's dropped by another like 3% this month.
Yeah.
Do you think, based off of the trend that people are using LLMs, except for like developers who use something like Copilot, but in general LLM usage is going down, that's kind of like that fad has hit the cryptocurrency curve that like NFTs and everything did, and it's just going away at this point? What do you think's going on there?
That's a little hard to answer. I mean, I do think it is going to become less popular over time, but I don't think that's a problem for them. I think ChatGPT especially made such a huge, like, national news coverage type deal. Everybody knew about it. Everyone wanted to try it out. In fact, the fact that it's only dropped by like 10% is actually even a little surprising to me. I assumed that number was going to be larger. I think the people who are going to use it are going to continue to use it. And I think, you know, a lot of what we're seeing people disconnect from it are people who just don't have as much a need for it. Because I'm assuming with just the way that reporting your corporate numbers works, someone using it in a quarter is even just logging in and doing one thing.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's not like, oh, well, if you ask less than 10 questions, it doesn't count. No, if you interface at all, it counts. And sure, I mean, I went in ChatGPT. What would have been the quarter before last, did that whole, like, I guess it would have been two quarters before, yeah. So I guess three quarters ago, I would have done the help me make the Thanksgiving dinner that we kind of talked about that went over really well. But then I didn't touch it at all. So I was part of that, you know, went down 10%. Then I played around with it a little bit more, and we were talking about like having it be a DM for a D&D campaign, which I was very impressed with that. I don't think we ever got to talk about it on a
We haven't talked about it on the podcast yet.
But its ability to try and run, even as a pure intrigue campaign that's no combat, was pretty good. It had a couple faults, but nothing crazy. So I mean, I guess, yeah, I was back for that quarter. Not using it right now.
Yeah.
Probably be gone for this quarter. So I don't think that's an issue, because people like me are going to come and go who are just going to kind of lightly use it. But the people who have integrated it into their workflows, or like, this is just a part of like what I do every day. I use it like a personal assistant or something like that. Those people are going to stick around, and those are really your actual market, where like new features are going to matter. If you decide to monetize the platform, the monetization is going to matter, you know, things like that.
Which they're already monetizing the platform, so, you know.
Yeah, I know they are for corporate entities. I don't think they're doing it for free.
No, they're doing it for, you can do it for people, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So, there's a subscription model they have. I think it's like $10 or $20 a month. And you can use it with the new features that they're rolling out, so you get access to those first.
Oh, okay, just get stuff early. Okay. Yeah.
And there may be a couple other perks, like you get the newer version of GPT or something like that.
Gotcha. Then, yeah, I mean, if your overall user base is slowly declining, but your part of your user base that's paying for it is not declining, I don't think that's an issue. If they're declining, the people that are actually paying for it are also in decline, that's more concerning, because you're losing your core base. But I think, you know, I think ChatGPT especially had a whole lot to lose in terms of number of users per quarter, because it was on CNN and Fox News and everywhere, and everybody was trying it.
Right.
So, you know, for a while there, your numbers are huge. You know, it's kind of like a fidget spinner, right? So, like, but fidget spinners went away. No one really, most people don't care about those anymore.
Right.
But ChatGPT is something you can charge for monthly when you're talking about a business model. As long as those core people are sticking around, they're not in any worse shape.
I think that's probably accurate. I think that is probably also only looking at one aspect of what they're doing with that. And I think that that's because they're talking about, you know, like the usage of like the apps and things like that.
Yeah.
Probably, you know, the way that things are going with their stuff. I think really where average people are going to interact with these things mostly are going to be things like search engines and stuff like that. I mean, like, for using it for workflows, most of the people, and I think the corporate numbers were the ones that were down, most of the people are finding that they have to correct it too much.
Yeah.
So I think that also is a problem overall with, you know, these LLMs. They're great. When I was at Cisco Live, I saw a ton of them being used to do all sorts of interesting things. But the accuracy problem with ChatGPT really hampered it from being like a large presence there.
Yeah.
Because corporate entities really want accuracy with whatever it is that they're using
absolutely.
These things for.
Yeah. And frankly, ChatGPT has been getting less accurate as time goes on because of how many people mess with it.
Well, they also nerfed it some.
Well, they did, yeah. But that was also then society, you know, came in and said you got to put certain things in there. It did just make me have the idea that I wonder how wrong I could get ChatGPT to do math that still looks like it's right. You know, like,
that would be interesting.
Could I convince it that like 9 + 9 = 17 and not 18, and then make it carry that forward?
Just going forward, like,
so like, yeah, when it was like 19 times 5, well, that would be off by a couple numbers, and then
yep.
Well, what's really 190 plus 190, if not 10 19s plus 10 19s, you know, and like how embedded can I get it by doing it, giving it targeted responses that it gives me something that's kind of close, but it's wrong because of something like that.
Right, right.
Because I think that's the core issue I think a lot of people with accuracy run into, is it's not like it spits out something that's just so wholly awfully wrong you have to keep asking it again and again. Is that it gives you something that's almost right.
Right. It's so close to right that if you don't check it.
Exactly. That's where all the real work is. Like, if it gave me something that didn't make sense, you say, hey, try that again. And it would give a second attempt and hopefully be right that second time. But when it's like, hey, go multiply all these numbers for me, I'm doing a quick little bit of accounting. Or, you know, oh, hey, help me come up to a decision about something. And it's just a little bit off. You won't catch that. But you'll get in trouble when it's wrong. You know?
I agree with you there. I don't think that it's going away, but I do think the fad of it has died.
Yeah, I think that's true. People don't really talk to me about like AI and stuff except other people who are like in the industry.
Yeah.
who care about it, or people who are out of the industry and are more worried about, like, what's it going to mean long term.
Right.
You know, like trends of markets and stuff like that.
Yeah, I 100% agree with that. Yeah. I mean, as far as the topic goes, that's exactly what I was hitting on. Like, mm-hmm. the trend of, like, you know, ChatGPT your life, you know, use it for everything. It's going to revolutionize everything. Get rid of your employees, you know, all that other stuff, right?
Yeah.
I don't think that that's... I mean, there's still companies out there that are going to try to do that because some executive was like, ChatGPT will, like, you know, save us a bunch of money or whatever. You know, I don't know why the executive became, like, some sort of Gomer Pyle. But, you know, like...
Well, that's all right. I was watching from a World Trade Forum of a CEO who was talking about unemployment.
Oh, yes. Like, yeah, oh, okay. Man, you're going to make me mad now. I get so mad every time I think about this.
Yeah, it made a couple rounds on the internet as the guy was being like, employees need to remember they work for us, not the other way around. We need employment to go up so that we can remind the workers they should be thankful that we allow them to work for us.
And I know what you meant because you said employment, but I know you meant unemployment because that's what he says.
Well, he was talking about employment overall.
Right.
Like that little snippet that made it around the internet was specifically about unemployment.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he was talking about employment overall, but we need unemployment to go up is what he said, I believe, an exact quote.
Yeah, he said it needs to go up like 30 or 50%.
Yeah, and just to show him who's boss.
Yeah, there needs to be pain in the economy, I think was the exact quote.
Yeah, so I will say this right now. If you're an employer and you don't realize that that you're just a guard in an asylum and the inmates just haven't realized that they actually outnumber you yet, you probably are a little delusional.
Yeah, I mean, I think really, especially as I get older, I kind of start realizing that the people who make tons of money in businesses, like the CEOs and the, you know, even like actors and stuff like that, people that the people that we look up to that are like huge, huge millionaires,
right?
Like, not John who opened a plumbing company and made $5 million,
but right?
Like, you know, Leonardo who said, okay, I now own an $800 million company,
right?
To get that kind of money, you just have to be okay with unethical things.
Yes, absolutely.
And that's a hard stance to take. I'm happy to meet a very nice, that's actually kind and didn't hurt anyone,
yep,
billionaire. But quite frankly, it's just hard to find any, period. Like, even people that people, you know, look to, like Bill Gates, who, like, does now spend a lot of his money on good causes.
Yeah.
I mean, he made that money being one of the most aggressive businessmen in tech.
He did, and also one of the most unethical people with, you know, like, forcing people to use his operating system.
Yeah. I mean, the policies weren't great. He bankrupted tons of companies to the point the government was pretty much going to shut him down.
Yep.
He had to go save Apple.
Yeah.
You know, his only way of not getting his company split up was to help a competitor be better.
Right.
So they could actually still be called a competitor.
I don't know that that's all 100% just why he made that decision. Because around that time he was having some, like, you know, hearing the man talk, there was some, there was some thoughts going on in his head. But I mean, clearly that did have a huge effect.
I mean, he gave a personal loan to Apple, like, not even the company. Like, he, Bill Gates, gave Steve Jobs something like it was like couple hundred thousand, like a couple million.
I think it was a couple million, to bail him out. I think he forgave some of that debt too.
Yeah, I'm not actually sure any of it got paid back because that's what they used to help launch the iPod.
Yep, that's right. So, you know, not talk that completely off topic, but a great topic. We might return to that later. It is very sad that human beings do that to one another. And I hope that if I ever get in a place or you ever get in a place that we will hold each other accountable enough that if you had billions of dollars, you know, I would have the ability to come to you and be like, Ricky, you're being one of those billionaires. You're being one of those terrible people.
Yeah, that's my thing. I mean, in all honesty, and it's becoming a pretty ingrained belief because I keep trying to look for exceptions. But apart from, like, obvious exceptions, some, like, random person wins the lottery.
Yeah.
You know, make some bet that just goes huge. You know, like, occasionally you see, like, regular people just really win in the stock market and stuff like that, which that makes sense. But, like, if you're, quote-unquote, I worked for my $10 billion, and it's, like, part of some business venture or something like that, I can almost guarantee that person has been okay with some very unethical things.
Yep.
And honestly, personally, you know, I'm not saying these people individually, are awful. But it's like all that stuff we sent over to China, you see the conditions of people in China. They've got literal slave camps of people they've imprisoned that they make do the work for them, you know, stuff like that. And it's like, that's unethical.
Right.
You, the person I'm looking at, did not go force those people to work. But you took your business to people that you knew would do those things.
Right.
You know, like there was a big, in like electronic vehicles, the whatever it is, the beryllium or whatever it is, that they have to get for the batteries and all that. There was a mine that's super heavily invested in that's like publicly touted as this is an ethical mine. There's no people here. It's all machines. Or I think they said there's like a couple people that like run the machines, but they're all paid very well. And then a reporter snuck in and it's, you can't see the mine for the people.
Right.
There's just thousands of people in piles just like sorting through dirt and like things like
finding the beryllium that the machines couldn't find.
Well, I mean, I'm not even sure there's any machines there apart from hand covered. It's just a lie.
Oh, I didn't realize
that. It's marketing. No, no, literally, like it looks into the mine and it's, you can't see the ground for the people.
God, that just makes me sick, man.
Yeah, and that's like
not good.
We're being sold this is the ethical product. And there's no way the big investors don't know.
Right.
Because big investors have so much at stake, they normally go and actually inspect the mines themselves.
Yes, absolutely.
So they know it's happening, but they're just happy with the public delusion that electric car is so much better for the environment, so much better for people. And we need to charge you extra because we're using the expensive ethical options.
Yes.
When they're not.
They're not. They're just, it's just a they're getting it on both ends.
Mm-hmm.
Double charging you. All right, I got to stop talking about this. I'm just going to be depressed the rest of the day. We're going to play D&D right after this, and I'm going to go in, and my character is just going to be nothing but sadness.
Yeah, but that's just your character. It's barely different.
Well, I mean, he's insane, not necessarily sad, but he did become sad there for a while.
Yeah, it's a tech campaign. It's like, it's not post-apocalyptic. It's like pre-lead into the apocalypse.
Yeah, of this world that we're playing in. Yeah, it's... but... I mean, he started out happy.
He definitely started out happy. We all started out happy.
Anyways, this has been Season 6, Episode 12 of the Beer and Broadband Podcast. It's slated to come out on September 25th, 2023. Hopefully, you'll tune in next time where we talk about other things other than sad, terrible things. I hope that's what happens. Anyways, we'll catch you next time. Have a good one.